and welcome to the show.
Hi, Jonas. Thank you. Good to be here again.
Ah, perfect. Today, I wanted to do a deep dive into the latest feature that we put into EC 365 Manager, and that is the Meeting Rooms feature.
Right. Yeah. Looking forward to that.
Yeah, I know it's a topic on a lot of companies' mind, how to utilize that Meeting Room feature. So let's hear about what did we do in EC 365 Manager regarding this.
Yeah, we had a lot of requests. As always, new features in EC 365 Manager are request-driven. So a lot of people came to us and said, well, we need to be able to manage rooms, meeting rooms, because we enjoy working with EC 365 Manager, but we still have to go into Exchange Admin Center to do the very specific configurations of meeting rooms. So we, based on that, we did a deep dive into that, and I think we came up with a pretty neat solution that I'd love to demo for you today.
Okay, that sounds great. So I think we should we dive into the feature?
Let's do that. I'm gonna fire up a machine here and we'll have a look at it. So here we are. I'm on my Windows 10 PC. I have Outlook up and running, and we are going to book a meeting. So the first thing I want to do is let's just have a look at what we've seen many people doing when they book a meeting room. So I'm going to give it a title here. I'm going to invite a couple of people to the meeting.
Yeah, so this is the normal way, right, that we see a lot of people do when they book meetings. Yeah.
This is the way you always start by booking a meeting room. You need to set up when you want to create the meeting. Let's do it on noon on Monday for a couple of hours. And then what you would do, what we've seen many people do earlier, is you go to the scheduling assistance, you click on add rooms, and then you know where is the meeting to be held. It's going to be in the headquarters in our Boston office. So people just, you know, add all of these rooms because then it's easy to see which rooms are available and which rooms are not available. So you can kind of use this to narrow down which room you're going to hold the meeting. A big issue here is that it's difficult to get an overview. How many people can these rooms accommodate? What properties are available for these rooms? So it's a very tedious way to do it and not very efficient. So I'm just going to roll back a little bit here, and instead we're going to use the Room Finder feature. So we already set up the necessary room lists and meeting rooms. And with Room Finder, it's super easy to book your meeting room. First step, you look at the building. Where are you going to hold the meeting? We're going to do this meeting in Boston. We're going to do it in our headquarters, which is placed on St. James Avenue. I immediately get a list of all the meeting rooms in that location. I can also see already now which ones are available and which ones are booked. And then you have a lot of information that can help you narrow down your booking request. So you have the capacity of the meeting rooms. And if, let's say you want to filter it down, you can do some filtering also. If you have like dozens of meeting rooms, you have some icons here that tell you about the accessibility. So if it's suitable for wheelchair users, you have information with icons also if there are specific audio or video or display devices. So I'm just going to narrow this down. I know that 6 people or more are going to be attending this meeting. So I set the capacity to 6, and immediately it's filtered down to only view meeting rooms with a capacity of 6 or more. You can also set which floor you want to hold the meeting on. And then for the features, you have, as mentioned, the display, video, audio devices. You have accessibility for the meeting room. But then you also have a number of tags which are like configured by the admin who set up the meeting rooms. And this can be anything. The list may be much longer, but you only see the features that are available from the remaining rooms in the list. So let's say we want, I know one of the people who's attending the meeting is using a wheelchair. I want to narrow down that. Immediately I get a more narrow filter, And then I would like it to be a VIP setting because some of the meeting attendants are external users and I want everything to look nice. And we're down to this particular meeting room. So as you see, it's super easy to go to the location where the meeting room is, the meeting is to be held, put up some filtering on the capacity, on the various properties of the room, and get a short list from which you can select the actual meeting room.
Ah, that's nice. That's very fast and intuitive to do. Great.
Yeah, perfect. So I hope you liked what you saw.
Yeah, it was very, very nice. Very nice feature. So, but how I know a lot of these details, you have to put them into the Office 365 platform. So how do we put all these features around audio and display, video devices, wheelchair accessibility, and all the other features, capacity? So this is something that we need to configure somewhere, right?
Yeah, that's right. And we basically have two items that we need to roll out this feature. You need to configure, of course, the meeting rooms with all the relevant properties. You need the information like the city, because we're doing filtering on cities. You need to configure the building where the meeting room is located. And then, of course, all the properties that characterize the room, if it's wheelchair accessible, and you can basically put in anything, any feature of the room that you want people to be able to search on. The other main feature or configuration you need, that's room lists. So it's a special type of distribution groups that you use to organize your meeting rooms, and so you can leverage this searching in Outlook or in Outlook Web Access.
Okay, how nice. So I guess this will be important for a lot of enterprise customers. They will utilize this feature.
Yeah, definitely. If you have loads of rooms, this is absolutely vital that you have a good configuration of your meeting rooms.
Yeah. And can you show me how to, as an admin, can you show me how to set that up, configure that in the backend?
I sure can. Let me fire up my machine again here. So I'm back on my Windows 10 PC. I have 80 users and computers installed, and I have the EC365 Manager Snap-in installed to make this a lot more comfortable. If we look at a meeting room, you have various properties that are needed. You need the address. For that, you need the city. The city is what you see in the room finder in Outlook. Also on the mailbox, because this is we can see the type is a room mailbox, and therefore we have room settings, and this is what we implemented in version 1.9. Here you have an overview of all the room settings that you find in Exchange Admin Center and a few more. So the building is another important feature that you need to configure to get this up and running. And then you have, here you have actually three parts. You have the room settings, which is the basic properties of the room. You have the floor, the wheelchair accessibility, capacity, the various devices, and you have the tags that are various features that are available for the room. Then you have another section here, booking processing. All these settings has to do with the processing of the meeting request. It has to do if you allow recurring meetings, if you allow booking of meetings outside of work hours, if you allow conflicts. You can also allow external organizers to book the meeting. Then you have a maximum duration of hours. How long can one meeting be? And you have a booking window, which says something about how far into the future are you able to book meetings. Then you have the...
Yeah, and then let me just ask a question. If we had some special meeting rooms that are only must be bookable for C-level persons, like the CEO, CFO, CIO, and all that,
right,
all those guys. So is there, and then we need to block that. So these are the guys that only can book this meeting. Is that somehow possible if we should do that?
Definitely possible, yeah. And that it's kind of the third section that you have here, booking permissions. This is where you can set up if everybody can book, if only certain people can book, or if you have an approve decline process that certain people must approve or decline the request. So it's pretty close to what you find in Exchange Admin Center, and then with some additional features. So for comparison, if we look at the room, let's just find it here in Exchange Admin Center. then well, one benefit here is that you have everything in one pane. You can easily identify the features that you want to configure. Whereas in Exchange Admin Center, you have like four different sections that you need to shuffle to identify the settings. So the main difference that you see here is in particular with regards to the duration, the booking window, and the decline recurring meetings. I wanna say a little thing about that, because if you go to booking in Exchange Admin Center and go to manage booking settings, then it's as if the booking window and the maximum duration is somehow related to the automatically declined meetings, because when I disable that, these settings are also disabled. So it's kind of, unfortunately, a misunderstanding by the guys who implemented the Exchange Admin Center. If you look to the documentation from Exchange Online, you'll find that these two settings are basically not related to this setting. So if this is enabled or disabled, it doesn't matter the maximum duration of meeting rooms, it's always in effect. The same goes for the booking window. If this is enabled or disabled, you are never able to book a meeting outside of the booking window. What this setting means is that if you have recurring meetings that exceed the booking window, you can decide with this setting if you want to decline the request entirely or if you want to allow it. But it always only goes to the booking window. So let's say you schedule a weekly meeting with no end. If this setting is off, it will be booked until 180 days into the future. If this setting is enabled, the meeting request will be declined. That's the meaning of this setting. If you look at it here, it's like it's somehow related with disables or enables the booking window and the maximum duration, and that's a unfortunately a complete misunderstanding.
Okay, that was very good to clarify that thing in the EAC. Okay.
So another thing I'd like to highlight is the booking permissions, where you can, we have three features available. Everybody can book, select delegates, or with approve and decline. You would expect delegation to be configured under delegation. But actually in Exchange Admin Center, you need to go to booking, and that's where you find the booking delegate settings. Although you have a top option called delegation, it's not there. If you go into this, we have in Exchange Admin Center two settings, automatic acceptance or declination of booking requests, and selected delegates who need to decline or accept the booking request. That's lacking a little bit the third feature that we have implemented, that only selected delegates can book. So let's say you have some management meeting rooms that the rooms are always booked by assistants of the managers. The only option they have with Exchange Admin Center is to configure themselves as delegates who can accept or decline, and then they will, every time they book the meeting room, they will have to book the room, get a notification from themselves, accept that, and then the room is booked. So in that scenario, this solution is not very good, but it's the only offering you have from Exchange Admin Center to limit who can book the meeting room. With this setting, selected delegates can book, you can simply just add these assistants. They will be able to book the room. Nobody else will be able to book it. So for that particular scenario, it's much more efficient with this third option. You can do it by a PowerShell, but in Exchange Admin Center, it's not available.
Okay, that's all right. Thank you for clarifying that. Yeah, it can be a bit confusing moving around in the Exchange Admin Center. So great, perfect. And regarding the room lists,
yes,
how do I create those?
Yeah, you to create room lists, you need to create a distribution group. Mm-hmm. Now we're in this scenario here. We are in a hybrid environment. So what you do is you create a universal or global distribution group, it doesn't matter. Make sure you mail enable it. That feature is also available via EC365 Manager. And once the group is mail enabled, you have the opportunity to configure it as a room list. It's simply by putting this checkbox here and clicking apply. In Exchange Admin Center, if you go to groups and you want to manage room lists, then you're in a little bit of trouble. because the room lists that I have configured here, if you go to those, it will say, we still don't support management of room lists. So that's kind of a rare admission from Microsoft that they still don't support management of room lists. I couldn't have said it better myself. So if you want to configure room lists, you have to use PowerShell if you don't have EC365 Manager. With PowerShell, you also have to do a great deal of investigation to figure out, is that something I configure in Exchange Online, or is it something I configure on my on-premises Active Directory attributes? With EC365 Manager, you don't have to worry about that because we'll make sure that things get written to the proper place.
Okay. So let me get this clear. So if I wanted to implement room lists in my organization, then I would need to go to PowerShell to make that configuration available.
If you don't have EC365 Manager, you will need to be doing a lot of PowerShell. You need PowerShell to configure the room lists. And if you want some of the nice features, like only allowing certain people to book meeting rooms without going through the accept decline procedure, then you would also need to use PowerShell for that.
Okay, that's really nice to know. All right, great. Thank you, Morten. And is there something else that we should take into consideration regarding creating room lists and making changes to meeting rooms in Exchange Online?
Yeah, I'm glad you asked, because there is one thing in particular that you need to pay attention to, and that is room list configuration. It takes almost always 24 hours or sometimes even more before they propagate to Exchange Online, and there's absolutely nothing you can do to speed that up. It's not a matter of cached information in Outlook or Outlook Web Access. It simply just takes a very long time for room list information to propagate to Exchange Online. So that's one thing to take into consideration. You need to take good care that you configure room lists correctly in the first go, because if you need to start troubleshooting room lists, you will have to wait for 24 hours every time you make a change that you hope will solve the problem. So the basic steps here is create a universal distribution group. Go to the Office 365 tab if you have a EC365 Manager, mail enable it, synchronize it to Azure AD. That will automatically provision a distribution group in Exchange Online. Once that's in place, enable the room list. And of course, in the membership, make sure that you have added all the meeting rooms that you want associated with this room list.
Mm. All right. Very nice.
Great.
All right, Morten. Thank you for detailing this great feature.
Yeah, glad to show it to you. I think it's based on user requests, and obviously a lot of people are already enjoying this feature. I hope you will too, Jonas.
Yeah, I certainly will, and I think that a lot of companies out there could really make a nice use of this feature. So that's perfect, Morten. Thank you. Thank you for this time.
You're
nice
welcome.
To see you again.
Nice to see you, Jonas. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.